Alongside angels, all despite the pain that you went through in life. Would you repent? Would you renew your mind? Would you go heal a blind? Follow my shiach and find the kingdom within? Or would you continue in sin? Think about all that's been going down, yeah, it's prophecy. Holy days kept though, poppin', see? Picking that's dead, they obviously really blind, need and eyes to teach. What you gonna do? It's time, my peeps. Kingdom at hand, judge on the way. Tomorrow ain't promised, life like a vapor. Seek your maker.
What if I told you that the kingdom's within us? What if I told you that Christ's blood's in us? What if I told you that His reign's within us? What if I told you that? What if I told you that?
What if I told you that you special in the eyes of the Abba? More money, more problems, and the outcome for a rich man getting in is harder. When it comes to the kingdom, love not the world. Come to the Father, gotta love pearls. Eschew evil, even from a girl. Kingdom over everything, lead him out the world. Lead him to the water, lead him to our Savior. Lead him to you martyred, lead him to our Maker. Let him know that Jacob, prince of the power, really gotta shape up. Angels coming with him, if we wicked, they gon' fade us. What if I told you, kingdom what you made of? Yeah, it's inside you, no need of hesitation. Yeah, it's inside you, faith and meditation.
What if I told you that the kingdom's within us? What if I told you that Christ's blood's in us? What if I told you that His reign's within us? What if I told you that? What if I told you that?
What if I told you that nothing was the same? It's like you wake from a bad dream and the pain's still in your brain. What if I told you that the choice was in your hands? You can choose vanity, reality, you keep calm, mistake your claim, mistake your claim. It's not happening, plug me back in. Gotta get back to the matrix, need my satisfaction, straight acting. What if I told you that the kingdom's who you are? And you done wasted your whole lifetime chasing dreams and falling stars? Christ is the key, renew your mind. Turn from all of your wickedness and please stop wasting time. He's here for the brokenhearted and He will free the blind. Prepare for His return and don't look back, you see the signs, you see the signs. Christ is the key, renew your mind. Turn from all of your wickedness and please stop wasting time. He's here for the brokenhearted
and
He will free the blind. Prepare
for
His
return
and don't look back, you see the signs, you see the signs, you see the signs.
This is the Born of Levi Experience on GOCC Media.
How we all doing? How we all doing? Peace and blessings, family. Welcome back to the Born of Levi Experience. I'm your host, Deacon Hazak, here with another fun-filled topic that we're going to discuss today. And that song, by the way, was Kingdom Within, which was by Hebrew Fresh or Deacon Zachariah, featuring myself, right? And McCall, his wife, right? So praise the Most High. And I wanted to play that song because it's so fitting for tonight's discussion. Y'all see the topic, right? Fake versus reality. Unplugging from this matrix, right? We are unplugging from this matrix. How we all doing in the room, first and foremost? How we all doing, man? And then, you know, like I do every week, if I'm coming in nice and clear, brothers and sisters, please put a qualm in the chat. Put a qualm in the chat for me to know if I'm coming in nice and clear. I want to make sure my audio is just right for you guys. And as you come in, please continue to hit that like button. Drive the traffic. Let everybody know that I'm on and that we're okay. Thank you, Tawada, for having a for putting the qualms there. And Shalom to all of the familiar faces or names. I keep saying faces, but I can see y'all faces too. Some of y'all got the y'all pictures on the icon, so that actually helps. Right, Shalom, Shalom, peace and blessings. Oh man, we got a great broadcast for you guys tonight. A great conversation. I don't want to be too long-winded, but it's going to be straightforward and to shed some light on some things that we already know. And for some of you guys who's probably brand new, who don't know anything about this, we're definitely going to shed some light for you so you guys can have some understanding in these last days, brothers and sisters. Right? So as you guys continue to come in, continue to hit that like button, right? I pray you all are having a great week thus far. My week was kind of slow. You know, I was on vacation this week, you know, got some things done and some things still undone, but you know, it's all a work in progress, brothers and sisters. So, you know, we're here. Yeah, man, it's a blessing to be alive. As a matter of fact, what a time to be alive. Everything that we see going on and on the news, everything we see going on social media, and social media is another thing, man. The things that I see on social media is like, why is this thing allowed to be played here? Some disturbing, some funny, some like, oh, eye-opening. It's just like so much information. We're being inundated with so much information at once during this time. And the scripture was not lying when the scripture said that, you know, many will run to and fro in these last days because knowledge shall increase on the earth. Listen, man, if you still don't have any access to any knowledge, it's because you're not seeking it. If there's certain information that you still don't know, it's because you're not seeking it. If there's certain things that's being hid from you, it's because you're not searching for it. You're not reading. So, shame on you. You know, if all this information is out here and you are not tapping in, right? But nonetheless, we are here for another broadcast. Peace and blessings. You know, and I want to give all praise to the Most High. His name is the great I Am that I Am, Ahaya Asho Ahaya. That's in the Hebrew tongue. And the name of his Savior, of our Savior, excuse me, his Son, Yeshaya Amashiach, or who the world ignorantly calls Jesus Christ. Yes, I said ignorantly because there is no letter J's in the Hebrew. So there was no way a Hebrew man would be named Jesus Christ, right? So we know him as Savior, which is Yeshaya Amashiach, or Yeshaya, or Christ the Anointed, or Yeshaya the Messiah. Tongue-tied right there, right? All right, but let's continue. So before we do that, I can't forget to do that. Before we continue, brothers and sisters, you know I have to do my weekly announcements, and it's very important that we do these announcements so that way we could have all of our brothers and sisters up to breast on what's going on with the church, right? So let me just pull this up here for you guys. Give me 1 second. So this episode of the Born of Levi Experience is currently brought to you by the Hebrew and Bible Academy. You want to get your Sunday morning dose of some Hebrew and Bible Academy. You want to enroll. I think we're going into week 5. But brothers and sisters, it's not too late to enroll. Okay, it's really not too late to enroll. You can visit historytimes.org, historytimes.org, and you can register to enroll. And don't worry about it. If you missed the prior lessons, they'll send you all of the previous lessons so you can catch up during the week and be right on course with everybody else. So everybody, if you want to join in, it's historytimes.org. Historytimes.org. Not only that, brothers and sisters, I also got to do this as well too. Right? You want to head over to our main church channel, our main church page, I should say. Right? A Gathering as One. If you want to attend, right? If you want to attend the first annual GOCC Music Summit, right? So the event is being held right now. It's being open to baptized members. First come, first serve with the baptized members. And after that, it will be open up to the general public. So you want to visit the main page and you want to log in and get your tickets. All right, you click here. You're still gonna have to log in for members, but you could go to the website goccroyaltysummit.com to sign up, right? It's happening June 7th and 8th in Augusta, Georgia, right? June 7th and the 8th in Augusta, Georgia. So brothers and sisters, you don't want to miss out. The first annual GOCC Royalty Summit, right? All right. What else we got here for you? And last but not least, we also have the GOCC Health Initiative, right? We've been making this announcement for the past 3 weeks now, probably more. But we definitely are in need, right? So for the GOCC Health Initiative, as we are entering into these last days, access to doctors, nutritionists, and overall good healthcare will become more challenging. With that being said, it is our aim as a church to become more self-sufficient in the health field, in the healthcare field. We are looking for qualified members to join us in this initiative in collaborating skills and information. If you are a doctor, a nurse, a holistic specialist, nutritionist, herbalist, or have skills and backgrounds in the healthcare field and want to join us in this initiative, please send your resume over to gocchealth@gmail.com. That's gocchealth@gmail.com. All right, so I had to clap it up for myself because that's a mouthful. That's a mouthful, but we got it all out the way, right? Praise the Most High. So we're going to get started with the broadcast. And once again, welcome, family. Welcome to all you guys who are now coming in. And thank you guys for being so generous and hitting that like button because it's completely free. It's no charge to you. So thank you guys for hitting that button and sharing the content and coming in, right? So we're going to talk about it. Fake versus reality. And for those of you guys who's been in the truth for a while, you guys already know what I'm talking about. But if you just stumble upon this broadcast, fake versus reality. So a lot of us don't even know that what we believe is reality is actually fake. So everything is actually in reverse. But to kind of explain that, I'm going to play this, right? Hopefully, if they give us an issue, I'll take it down, I'll whatever the case is. But I'm going to play the audio. And the audio I'm going to play is from a famous movie. A lot of you guys may have, know this movie. If you was brought up in the 90s, this movie actually came out in 99, I believe, 98 or 99. It's called The Matrix. I mean, a one-of-a-kind movie, in its time. Like, no movie compared to this movie when this movie dropped. Like, I mean, the animation, the graphics, everything about this movie was just like, yo, what is this, right? But the message behind the movie is what's so much greater from the first Matrix. So I'm going to play an audio from it. And it's like the reason why I want to play the audio because it's going to help to paint the picture for tonight's broadcast as far as fake versus reality. Right, this world, we've been given a reality that's not the reality. When everything is all said and done, a lot of us would spend our whole lives chasing something that's not actually real. So we have to actually separate the fake, this reality that has been given to us, which is actually the fake, from the reality that is to come or that is. That we've come to find out is the real truth once we open up and crack open that Bible. And the thing about that Bible exposes everything. It makes everything plain and exposes so much. And for someone to say at this point in time, especially in this day and age, that the Bible is man-made, you fall under that umbrella that I said in the beginning that if you still don't have any information, it's because of you. You're not reading. You're not searching. Because it's impossible for you to read the Bible and to say that the Bible was written by a man. It's impossible. But nonetheless, you also have to have the eyes to see as well, too. But hence the movie The Matrix, where Neo was presented. And for those of you guys who I know there's a lot of you guys who's probably watching right now who never even heard of the movie called Matrix. A lot of you guys are fairly young, which is okay. It's okay. Right? But The character named Neo was presented with a choice. Right? He was presented with a choice to see, would he want to continue to live the life that he was living and act like nothing is happening, or be awakened to the truth? All right, so let me try to play this real quick. But what I will do is I will play the I'll play the audio in the background, but I'm also have an image up. So, you know, hopefully if they give us a problem, you know, you guys could go back and watch the actual clip yourself, or go and I will actually watch the movie. But you know, I will take it down, whatever the case is, if they try to hit us with a copyright strike or whatever the case is, which I doubt. You know, we're not getting paid from this channel. Like, we're not monetizing, so we can't make any money off this clip, right? But yeah, let me play it so that way you guys could see where this is heading. Let me try to do this real quick. So listen clearly.
Do you want to know what it is? The Matrix is everywhere. It is all around us. Even now, in this very room. You can see it when you look out your window or when you turn on your television. You can feel it when you go to work, when you go to church, when you pay your taxes. It is the world that has been pulled over your eyes to blind you from the truth.
What truth?
That you are a slave, Neo. Like everyone else, you were born into bondage, born into a prison that you cannot smell or taste or touch. A prison for your mind. Unfortunately, no one can be told what the Matrix is. You have to see it for yourself.
You have to see it for yourself.
This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill, the story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want to believe. You take the red pill, you stay in Wonderland, and I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. Remember, all I'm offering is the truth, nothing more.
Truth.
Follow me.
All right, so we see here, we heard the clip. Very, very famous scene. Very, very, very famous scene in the Matrix trilogy, or in the series, right? He offered them the choice. He said that we're living in a time, or this world, the reality of the world is all around, or the Matrix is all around us, right? You could feel it when you go to church, when you go to work, when you go to school. It's everywhere. You have been told a lie, but I will show you the truth. And he gave him, he actually had the two pills, right? The blue pill, you take it, you go back to regular life. Nothing happens here. Or you could take the red pill and you can see how deep this rabbit hole goes. That's why I pulled up St. John 8, verse 32. Right? Immediately, that's the immediately that's the scripture that come to my mind when seeing that clip. Our Lord and our Savior tell us in St. John 8, verse 32, "And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." It's not that it can't, it won't, but the truth have the capability to make one free. How is that? Because now I can decipher if what you're giving me is actually suitable to me once I actually know the truth. Right? Yeah. Right? So once you are presented with the truth, then you should be able to make a conscious decision of, should I continue in a lie or should I continue in the truth? And that's what I wish that this world that we're living in, I wish it was that easy. Why am I saying that? Because for a lot of us, especially for a lot of us streaming or looking at this right now, we had to go through a lot of hoops, a lot of trials, a lot of trial and error just to find this truth that we're living in right now. And it's like once we are privy to the truth and things are being made known to us and we understand what's this and what's that, it's like, man, why couldn't they just tell or give us a conscious choice? But you know what it is? They can't do that, right? That's why Satan is a deceiver. He has to win you over through deception. Anything contrary to the Most High God, you have to be introduced to it by deception, no matter what it is. A lot of people think them turning to the left-hand side and receiving power on the left-hand side under Satan. Yes. You're receiving power on the left-hand side. Not from the Bible. Not from the God of the Bible. But the God of this earth. A lot of people feel like they receiving that power is the truth to them. But not understanding that power that you're tapping into is a lesser power, because there's a power that's greater than that. And back to the point, no matter what walk of life you choose to follow outside of the Most High God, your side has already been chosen. You're already with Satan. You already have chosen to be with the deceiver. A lot of people are being deceived into following a lie. And my thing is, Why not present everybody with both sides? Because there's only two sides in this earth. There's only two sides. It's either good or evil. Good being following the law, statute, and commandments and giving your life to Christ and being baptized for the remission of your sins. That's the side of good. Evil is everything contrary to that. You want to do your own thing. You want to deal with witchcraft, necromancing, voodoo, all of this madness, hip hop, the hip hop industry, the film industry, the fashion industry. And a matter of fact, I'm going to talk about all three of those to show you the deception in all three of them. And leading up to the main apparatus, which is the government. So you want to tap into these things. Automatically, you already chose a side. It doesn't matter if you didn't know. It don't matter if you say, I'm a good person. You've already chosen the side of that fake reality. Because everything that's going to come from that is fake. It's not real. And I just wish that they presented people with the choice. All right, well, this is what we're doing right here. We're serving Satan. We deal with different worships, idol worships. We drink blood. We do all of this madness. And there's also the side over here where people choose to follow God and believe in Christ. We're offering these two choices. You guys should choose. Only if it was that simple. Life would be simple if they just made the two choices readily available for everybody. But the thing is, they can't, because they have to win you over by deception. And this is the reason why Christ offered this. Christ said, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. And here's the thing, brothers and sisters. What Christ is doing something that the world powers is not even bold enough to do. To be presented with the truth
you have to also be presented with the lie. Isn't that fair? So if I'm going to know the truth, in order for me to know the truth, I have to also know the lie. So that way now, as an individual, I can make a conscious choice as to, well, am I going to follow evil or am I going to follow good? Christ offers that. But the governments of this world or the industries of this world, they're only going to present to you what looks good. Yeah, look, you can make all this fame and fortune. You can make all of this money. You could be rich and famous. Your name could be on billboards. Your record could be, you could go platinum, multi. You could be a multi-platinum recording artist. Matter of fact, you could be on every hit box office movie for this summer. But they're only presenting you with one side. So how is that even fair? How is that the truth? Because what's the other side of the coin? But Christ did something that no other leader, no other God on this earth actually is doing. He's not only going to give you the truth, but he's going to expose the wickedness so you can make a proper choice to choose the truth. I don't know if y'all ever understood that or if y'all seen it like that. Right? So we gotta be able, as disciples of Christ, as forerunners of the gospel, as stewards, I should say, also as well, to this gospel, right? Stewards working for this ministry, working for the kingdom to come, because this is not our kingdom. Right now we're putting the bricks down for our kingdom. So now, as builders of this kingdom, right, we have to be able to show the differences between the two. We have to be able to expose the lies. We have to be able to expose the works of darkness. We got to be able to show what's fake versus what is reality. Because you turn on your TV, you turn on Instagram, you turn on TikTok, you go on Facebook, you're not going to see what reality is. Right? So let's talk about it. Let's talk about the fake. I broke it down into three factions. Fashion, right? Music, and the film industry or Hollywood. But I want to start with the entry level of things, which is music. The music industry is like the entry level into this fake reality that they provide for the inhabitants of this earth, for all of us. It's music, right? So now, let me pull this up real quick. Continue to hit that like button, brothers and sisters. Give me 1 second, brothers and sisters. All right. So let me pull this up. I'm going to show a couple of videos and we'll talk about it. So like I said, it's actually four factions, but the first three is entry level, right? The first way they get you, they pull you in through the music. So let me see this. All right. Let's start with the music industry. And there was another video that I wanted to play, but it had too much curses, and I didn't have time to actually go in and put bleeps and all of that stuff, so I couldn't really play that one. But it was from the podcast. A lot of you guys may be familiar with his show, Math Hoffa, and a lot of his shows, he talk about a lot of conspiracies and trying to figure out if hip hop. Or do hip hop artists sell their soul to the devil? And the thing is, they it's like a circular argument that they all basically have in that barbershop, because we already know. Come on, we already know. And before, I remember in the early 90s, before, you know, before I knew that stuff, you know, we used to just listen to music, listen to hip hop. And it was just good. Like, it made you feel good. It made you move. But then as we started getting older, like I'll say late 90s, early starting to go into the early 2000s, to the early 2000s, we just started seeing how, or being exposed to how, a lot of the mainstream artists, or mainstream artists, right? A lot of the mainstream artists, they were incorporating satanic imagery, satanic lyrics into their music. And it just started opening up our eyes to understand that there was something deeper in the hip hop culture. You know, it was always known that was that genre, heavy metal. Like, you didn't have to as a young kid, you didn't have to tell me that that heavy metal was satanic. It just looks satanic. The screaming and the imagery, you know, the six-pointed stars on the shirts and all of that stuff. Their concerts, they're crazy cutting themselves. So we already knew heavy metal, certain parts of rock was already dabbling into satanic practices and worships and imagery, right? But we didn't think like that for hip-hop. So let me play this. So, you know, we started getting exposed to that, and then now we know that, okay, hip hop is shrouded in Satanism, a lot of satanic practices, and everything, and imagery, and all of these things. So this video is titled "Do These Rappers Worship the Devil?" And we all know the answer to that, because I'm gonna read that scripture in Luke chapter 4 after this, right? I'm gonna read a scripture, but we're gonna know. And remember, I said Christ told us that we shall know the truth. So in order for us to know the truth, we have to also see the lie. We have to know the lie, so that way we could be able to decipher what's true and what's not. So now, it's evident that in order for you to take part of anything glamorous in this life or in this world, it has to be attached to a power outside of the God of the Bible. And I'm going to explain that. But look, let's look at this video real quick.
And then YouTube, it's me, Lecrae. I'm back. Yes, indeed, man. And we are here, as usual, discussing topics on faith, hip-hop, and culture. That's what we do over here at this channel, man, and I appreciate all y'all for being here. What I need y'all to do before we get this thing jumping off, because it's gonna jump off today, is I need you to like and subscribe. That's what you got to do to be a part of this family, okay? You like, and then you subscribe, and then we family, and you will stay abreast of everything.
All right,
we
got. Let's go.
That being said, lesson. All kinds of satanic things in hip-hop music. Interesting, right? It's not new. I know some people look at artists like Playboi Carti, Trippie Redd.
Y'all seen that? Look, like, why would you? Where's that image? I'm trying to pull it back so you guys could see. Let me pull it back just a little bit.
Playboi Carti.
Like, look at that. What is that? What is that on the middle of the ground? We know that to be the six-pointed star. And this is a symbol that's highly used in the occult or in satanic worships, right? Why would you lay in that? and you're shooting a music video. What is that? What does your music have to do with this symbol? But let's continue.
Trippy Red, and they're like, what is this thing that's happening? Even with Lil Nas X and the blood in the shoes, which I did make a video for that. Make sure you check that one out as well. People are asking me, like, what do I think? What do you think about this, Lecrae? Man, it's wild. It's not really new. It's kind of something that's been going on in terms of people playing with the imagery and some of these types of things. I remember back in the day, Houston rapper Gangsta Nip, he was talking about a lot of crazy stuff when I was a little kid. Then you had 3-6 Mafia. I remember Bone Thugs and Harmony was talking about Ouija boards. And so,
and I remember when those things were starting to get exposed, like 3-6 Mafia, right? When they started, like it's like out of nowhere, like I'll be living like 2007 or 8. They just blew up out of nowhere. They just came out of nowhere, just blew up. Them, Bone Thugs and Harmony, when those rap groups started getting exposed for satanic worship, then I started paying attention. I'm like, yo, this is kind of demonic. So we started to pick up on these things, right?
It's not as if this is like some kind of new phenomenon within hip hop. It's something that I think hip hop has been dabbling in for quite some time. Here's my thing. If you play with the devil, he gonna play back.
I like that saying because I have a saying when it comes to if you're going to dance with the devil. Mine is, if you're going to dance with the devil, you better not stop dancing because he don't get tired. He going to keep dancing. If you're going to dance with the devil, you better not get tired.
Now, what are we talking about here? Honestly, when we talk about the devil in hip-hop music or in any other genre of music, what are we really talking about? Because I think oftentimes we get caught up in the ideas of symbols and things along those lines, when truthfully, is that really what the devil's all about? I mean, maybe he's got some symbols and some trademarks or something like that, but mostly he's just a liar, right? When you look in the scriptures, it says like your father Satan is a liar. He's the father of lies. He's been lying from the beginning. So really what you're dealing with is a liar. He's someone who wants you to believe that things that are true are actually not true.
You see that? The fake versus reality. He has to present you with the deception to capture you. And that's why, and it goes back to what I was saying earlier. It would be so much simpler if they would just present us with both sides. I would say that would be a fair exchange. But they can't do that. Because ultimately, the natural mind, the natural man or woman would not off the back pick evil. We wouldn't do it. If you present mankind with a choice of good and evil, by default, mankind would choose good. So they can't just come out openly and say, okay, here's the choice. All right, you could either serve Satan or you could serve God. They're not going to do that. It has to be done through deception. And this is why we have to be the ones to expose the falsehoods or what's fake versus what is reality.
Or things that, aren't true are true. It's like false realities. So it's not so much about the symbolism, it's more about the realities that are being painted. And I think like hip hop music, whether it has symbols or not, can always be painting pictures of false realities, right? Mm-hmm. And that's the goal, is for you to believe false realities. Some people, they wanna paint pictures and pentagrams and all kinds of stuff like that. But truthfully, I would say most of them do that for shock value and just to like, ha ha, look at me, I'm such a rebel, I'm coloring outside the line.
I don't necessarily believe that. I don't necessarily believe that they would purposely put satanic imagery in their things just for shock value or just to make people look, look at this, he's worshiping the devil, just or create a buzz. I believe that they really have to do these things because you're initiated into this worship now. Matter of fact, let me pause this. Just to prove what I'm saying. There's no way you're gonna be on this great pedestal and not have to pay homage to who is giving you this this platform. You have to play fair. You have to. right? Hold on real quick. Let me go here real quick. I was going to save this for later, but let me get this for you right now. One second. Luke, I'm in the book of Luke, right? Luke chapter 4. So look, let me show you the reason why I'm saying what I'm saying. Right? Luke 4. And we understand that this took place right after Christ's baptism, right? Starting his ministry, he was tempted. So it says here, and Yeshaya, being filled of the Holy Spirit, returned from Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, being 40 days tempted of the devil. See, that's what he does. He's going to tempt you. He ain't going to present you with the truth, but he's going to tempt you with something that's a lie. But he's going to present it to you to make it look like, oh, it's appealing, I want it. And we're going to see it here, right? And it says, and in those days, he did eat nothing. And when there were, and when they were ended, he afterward hungered, right? So he was fasting. And the devil said unto him, so you see here, the word devil there, deceiver, the deceiver came, right? So he had to deceive him. He couldn't present him with the truth. And the devil said unto him, if thou be the Son of God, command this stone that it be made bread. And Yeshaya answered him and saying, it is written that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. And the devil taketh him into an high mountain and showed unto him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. So now when you even look at this, you said, it says he showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of a time. So meaning he flashed to him and showed him not just the present kingdom, but the future kingdoms in remote places, all the kingdoms of that would take place on the earth. So he had the capability to show him future events and showing him the kingdoms of the world and showing him how glorious and how elaborate these kingdoms would be, right? So now he said, and the devil said unto him, all this power will I give thee and the glory of them. So you see, it was in his power to give it, the devil. He said, all this power will I give thee and the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me. So he's already telling us, or he told Christ, that this was his power to give. So keep that in mind, right? Our Lord and our Savior was presented with this information. He was presented with an opportunity to be able to rule all kingdoms. And who was authorizing that? The God of this world, the devil. And to whomsoever, you see, and look, I'm going to read that again. And he says, and the devil said unto him, all this power will I give thee and the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me and to whomever I will give it. So whoever he wants to give it to, they will get it. But what's the other side of that? Now, take a look at this. Here's the stipulation unto how I can give you all of this, because it's in my power to give it to you. If thou therefore wilt worship me, all shall be thine. So we see here that Christ was given the opportunity to receive all the power from the kingdoms, all the wealth, all of the notoriety, the exposure, in exchange for his worship. So now, when we see these artists, right, hip-hop artists, put these demonic symbols in their music videos, the way they dress, they dress with demonic imagery on them. They throw up the Baphomet. Some of them throw up that diamond sign, which is not even a diamond, is a triangle, right? Symbolizing the all-seeing eye, which is also leading back to Satan himself. He's trying to be all in all, right? And we see even with, I would say in Hollywood, with these mainstream artists, or I should say actors, they even have to go into a certain type of level of worships to acquire the fame that they have been given. Because we just read it, when Christ was offered that. But in exchange for it, all he wanted was your worship. So now, are they doing it unknowingly? I don't believe they're doing it unknowingly. I believe they fully understand who they're worshiping, who they're giving their adoration, and who's responsible for their wealth and who's giving them their wealth. They know. All right. So it's not like they don't know and they're just, it's a mistake. I didn't really know. Nah, you knew. You knew because it was presented to Christ. So, of course, it was also presented to you. So they're presented with a fake sense of reality. Like, all right, you could get all of this. You could get all of that. But at what cost? Christ also told us, he said, yo, what profit is it for a man to gain the whole world, but at the end to lose your very soul? So remember, I told you, Christ is doing something that no other leader on this earth was willing to do. He was going to present you with both sides, right? Christ has basically told us, if you choose that offer that he was offered in Luke chapter 4, you gain the whole world, but at what cost? Your soul. Because that's what this whole life is about. That's the fake and the reality of it. The fake part of it is, all right, you could obtain all this wealth. You could obtain all of this entertainment, all of this this popularity. You could be seen by millions. But at the end, you lose your soul. Now at the end, when your soul is burning in hell and in torments and you're being tormented, you're going to look back at your life and be like, yo, was it worth it? Was it really worth my soul that I'm in these torments, right? And a lot of people don't even consider that. So I wanted to bring that up to show that, yeah, you know, I do believe that they are fully aware. Maybe in the beginning of their contracts, right? And maybe in the beginning of their contracts where they're trying to get put on, and let me take this off the screen. When they're trying to get put on, and you know, they're starting out, and you know, they have the A&Rs and they have their record execs, and they're telling them, all right, yeah, we're just gonna put this, we're gonna shoot a scene for your video, but you know, we're gonna have this right here, upside down cross. It's for decoration. Some of them, I'm giving them the benefit of the doubt, right? Some of them may not have control, but as you get up in the ranks and you start seeing certain type of money and you start being seen, you get offered, right? You know what I'm saying? You get these offers and they're presented with the false reality. So that's the entry level of this fake reality that we're living. They throw the music industry at you. You know, then after that, you get into the music. What goes hand in hand with the music is what? Fashion. Look. Let me play this video. I'm going to play two videos. Right? I'm going to play two videos. Where is it? Let me play this video real quick. Ah, I'm sorry. This thing keeps on going back and forth. Give me 1 second. All right. And this is for a fair use only. Let me show you guys this video real quick. So it says, models tell all, explanation and abuse in the fashion industry. Yeah, even in the fashion industry. So let's take a look at this.
The picture that many people have is that models are very privileged, they're making tons of money, they're trotting all over the globe, walking down red carpets.
Models are often seen as this higher being or this untouchable figure.
You're gonna sign a contract, you're gonna become famous, and you're gonna make it.
That image and the reality are, for the vast majority of people working in the industry, very different.
The ugly side of modeling, going into fashion.
I had worked as a child model from the age of 14. Even though I was lucky in my career, I also experienced the pitfalls of working in a largely unregulated industry. Fashion is an aspirational business where there are many more people who want to gain entry to the business than are gonna get legitimate modeling work. There's a carrot being dangled in front of you. And, you know, there are the sort of lucky few who do.
So there's a carrot being dangled in front of you. Like it's like you're chasing something that you'll never be able to catch, really.
Make it and make a lot of money. But for the most part, the everyday working model or person who's trying to break into the industry, they're really vulnerable.
Young me in the industry was just definitely on my own.
I walked into women model management here in New York.
Yo, look at her face. She looked like she's been through a lot. And that's what these industries do to you. You lose sleep, you lose yourself, you be doing drugs, you be into all type of madness trying to just get your face on a billboard. Was it worth it? You don't even look the same anymore.
Which is a big agency, and they had me sign a contract, and I asked for more time to look over it. Sergio, the CFO at the time, told me, don't bother reading it, you're not gonna understand it anyway.
It's just such a huge opportunity just to even be signed that you don't actually question these contracts. And also, everybody wants this opportunity. You're on the other end of a very short stick.
When I first got discovered, I was 16. I barely spoke English. Like, I just came as a refugee. But all I knew is that I can make money to change my life. And that's what I wanted to do for my family.
You see? And that's what it is for a lot of people. A lot of people come from impoverished situations, impoverished countries, grow up poor, and all they want is a better life. They just want a better life for themselves and their family, but they do that selling themselves. And this goes back to what Christ said: what profit is a man to gain the world but you lost your soul? Your morality is also tied to your soul. A lot of the immoral things that people have to do just to obtain some level of wealth and fame and fortune. Is it worth it? Y'all see what's happening to y'all boy right now? What's his name? What that meme called him? D Pity.
Emily, we're dealing with a mostly young female immigrant workforce who basically don't have basic rights and protections on the job. Agencies through which models and artists work claim that booking jobs for the talent is incidental to their primary role of providing advice. And that very conveniently means that while the agency has exclusive control of their bookings and negotiations and working lives, that they don't have any responsibility to the people they represent.
So for a lot of these talent agencies or modeling agencies, they actually own the rights to your likeness. That's basically what it is. When you sign these contracts, they now own you. And that goes into any field that you're going into as far as entertainment. When it goes into music, the music side of things, or entertainment, fashion side of entertainment, or even acting, filming, these companies or these agencies, these so-called talent agencies, they own you. They make the decisions on what you wear, where you go, what you put on. So even when you look at these young NBA players, these stars, right? It's like, and it becomes like, now it becomes a fashion show before the game. Y'all guys realize that? Have y'all realized that before they go to the game, when they walk in through the tunnel, or I would say the parking lot area of the arena, they're coming in their nice outfits, expensive clothes, right? And some of them questionable, like, yo, why is this brother wearing a skirt right now and have a purse? When you sign these contracts, it comes with a handler, an A&R, right? Or what they would call an agent for a lot of the athletes. And you're that position comes with also, you get assigned a stylist, right? Your stylist, if you're signing some type of deal, what's the name of that? If you're doing promotional deals with these up and coming fashion designers, or somebody just want you to try on, like, you know, let me just give him this hat, and if he wears this hat, people's gonna see my brand, right? So a lot of the stuff that we see that these athletes that they're wearing is because they got paid to wear some of these things. But before they got into the NBA, they wasn't dressing the way we see them dress. Somebody paid you to put that on so that way you could show it off to the world, and somebody who's young and impressionable, like, yo, that's hot. I like that. I'm gonna go get that. You gonna go get a purse? That's what you're telling me. You wanna start wearing a skirt? But that's what comes with those positions. You're no longer your own person. You have to actually be what they tell you to be. The higher you climb on the ladder, and notice, when these athletes, when they're coming through the tunnel, when they're coming through the arena, they're not showing the people who's not the stars. They're not showing the bench. They're showing the top man on the team. They're showing the superstar athlete, because he's the one that all of the kids want to see. He's the one that the people want to watch. So, of course, I'm going to put him in a skirt, or I'm going to put him in a purse. I'm going to put these designer clothes on him because that's who the people want to see. He's the influence. You see? So, and she just said it, that these so-called talent agencies, they own you. Once you sign these contracts, they actually own you. They tell you where to go. They tell you what to put on. They tell you what time to show up. You have no say. That's why now it makes more sense when Christ was saying, what profit is it for you to gain the world, but you're losing your soul? You're not even yourself anymore. You're not who people knew who you were, because you're going to be what they tell you to be. You're going to worship what they tell you to worship. If you want to keep this job, you want that check to still keep coming in, you got to be who we tell you to be. Right, so that's the fashion side of things, right? And we're going to move right along with this. We're going to move right along. And once again, brothers and sisters, please continue to hit that like button. Excuse me. Continue to hit that like button on your way in. It's very important you guys do so we could drive the traffic, right? So we touched on the music industry somewhat, right? The hip-hop culture. Then we moved in, because once you get into the hip hop culture, you want to go right into fashion, because that works hand in hand. Hip hop and fashion. Hip hop actually shaped the way we dress as a people. I know especially for the black community, right? Hip hop played a large influence or was a big influence on how we dressed. What we understood was high fashion, right? We found that out through hip hop. If it wasn't for hip hop, we, you know what I'm saying? What would fashion be? So those two work hand in hand. And we see that because we've seen that how even Kanye West, he started off as what? As a hip hop artist, a producer first, then an artist. And then he tried his hand in what? In fashion. But even in the fashion industry, there was only so far that he could get because that's even controlled on another level. That's why we see these people, and I know a lot of y'all remember, I wonder if they even still have that show, America's Next Top Model. I remember watching some of those episodes with my sister years ago. And just seeing what these sisters would put themselves through just to be what's called America's Next Top Model. Some of the stuff was kind of degrading. I'm like, yo, is that serious? You really want to be a model that bad? And some of them look like they need to eat some food. Like, good Lord. Like, I could just see bone. I'll just be looking at some of these models. I'm like, yo, I know you're hungry. A person like me, I would pull up to one of their model shoots with a bucket of fried chicken. Like, yo, you want some? You hungry? I know you hungry. They be looking worse than the children in Somalia from those commercials with the flies flying around. I'm like, yo, y'all need to eat. If I gotta starve myself to be a model, I don't want nothing to do with that because I like to eat. Good, my goodness. But anyways, so we spoke about the music industry. Now we seen how the music industry and the fashion industry, you know, it goes hand in hand. Because, you know, like I said, hip hop and the music culture, it shaped a lot of how are the decisions that we chose as far as what we decided to wear, what was in, what was not in, right? So these things are influential, right? Now, when you get into that, you getting high up in that. Now, you also want to, what? You also want to, you want to dabble into the film industry. Let's see what I got here. Right? Let me get this video up here. Okay. Right. So now we're actually seeing we're seeing the dark sides of these industries. Hip hop with the satanic imagery and selling yourself, fashion, and that even, it's crazy how fashion even trickled down into sports. Because like I said, a lot of these superstars or, you know, these all-stars in these sports, they come decked out with the latest fashion on. And I'm like, yo, I know you was not dressing like that when you was in the hood. You didn't have a belly shirt on with bell bottoms. You was not dressing like that with a bag to match. You wasn't doing that. But as soon as you became a star, you know, you could turn around and tell me, brother, this is Balenciaga. Well, you could kill it. You could keep your belly shirt Balenciaga. You could keep that. I'm not wearing that. Brother, this belt is like $900. Yeah? You know what I could do with $900 right now? I ain't gonna buy a dang belt with it. But it's okay for them to do it because they're the high influential. They need to put it on them so that way we could lust after these things. And it's all about the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh. And the pride of life. This is what we're up against. This is what we're battling against. And this is the reason why a lot of people would choose this false reality rather than choose reality, because of the status you get, the social high social status that you get for wearing another man's name on your back. You have to think about it like that. I'm paying close to rent for a t-shirt because it has another man's name on it. Let's let that marinate just for a little bit. I'm going to buy a t-shirt with holes in it, which is dang near the price of someone's rent, because it has another man's name on it. And because it has another man's name on it, and I put it on my body, it means something to me. Or I mean something to the world. I'm still trying to figure out what is the point. Is it that you want to show people that you have money? Or is it that you're really proud to have another man's name on your back? I don't know. So we see, we're exposing the falsehoods of these industries. Music, fashion. Now let's go into Hollywood. So this is the satanic cult of Hollywood. So notice how everything is leading back to satanic practices. I mean, we didn't go too far down the rabbit hole with fashion, but we already know at the end of that rabbit hole, it's tied to a satanic cult. And I can confidently say that, and I can boldly say that, because we just read it in Luke chapter 4. And if it's Satan's to give, for them to be in those positions, you want to be America's next top model, whose position is it to give? We'll just leave it right there. So now let's take a look at this video. Let's get it.
When I would work these high profile events, it dawned upon me a pattern that a lot of them were pro-Zionism. A lot of them. Mm-hmm. And I would.
Oh, he said a lot of these organizations was pro-Zionism. Hmm.
Even boldly say maybe all of them.
Mm-hmm.
Considering that they run that industry.
Over the years, many artists, actors, and famous people have been reported as being a part of a cult, or openly symbolizing Satanism once they reach the peak of their fame. Many insiders have now spoken out, exposing this satanic cult and the evil they do behind closed doors. And the reality is far more sinister than what you could even imagine.
Hollywood started from the Zionists. And if you look around the world, Hollywood is the central broadcast center of the world. Everybody wants to follow the stars, follow, you know, the dreams, the land of hope.
And I wonder why it's the center. Because remember, Satan can't give you the truth. He has to give you the deception to make you fall into it. So why not use the Hollywood apparatus to gain souls and to convince everyone in the world you want to be a part of this? Because look how glamorous this is. Look how much money these people are making. Look, their names is on billboards, is in lights. Matter of fact, if you do good enough, we'll put your name on a star in Hollywood. See? And people want that. But what is the other side of the bargain? There's two sides. You're going to get all of this, but what's the other side of it?
Open, so on and so forth. So when I work for these people, you could feel a strong presence of, we care only for our people. And we're in charge.
Were these people who were, would you say, following the example of Moses?
No.
Religious people?
No.
No?
No, considering if they were following Moses, peace be upon him, and all the other prophets, according to their scripture, why are they producing movies that are immorality?
There goes a great question. If y'all are really supposed to be the people of the book, and the people of the book, they had a strict law that they followed, a holy law, why are you in turn pushing immorality? And not just pushing it, but you're incentivizing it. Debauchery, drug use, alternative lifestyles. There's no way you guys could be the people of the book if you're going to push immorality. Great point.
at its finest. It wouldn't make sense, a God-fearing person, to put immorality and broadcast it, calling to evil. So these people, either they hide under the guise of the religion, you know, using the religion to their means,
yeah,
or they're wolves in sheep's clothing, basically.
Mm-hmm.
And these people, you know, unfortunately, they shift society gradually. Like, if you look at how men and women behaved only 100 years ago, totally different.
Mm-hmm.
Versus today. You know, with the...
And that's the truth. They did shift society. And it was through the eyes of media or entertainment that was able to push that narrative as to where now, where the standard was a mother, father, children in the home, and the family structure. Now is not. Now is, yo, do your own thing. Do as thou wilt. Matter of fact, yeah, it's okay to be a baby mama. Just put them on child support. It's okay to have baby mamas. It's okay to sleep around. It's okay to be doing this. Matter of fact, it's okay to have crimes and to kill off your own people. Matter of fact, it's okay to use drugs. All that was being done and being promoted through media or through entertainment, I should say, what they call entertainment. So that's how it was able to shift the narrative of how we think, starting first with the music. The music infiltrated our neighborhood, infiltrated the minds of the young, right? It infiltrated their minds, changing the way they think. Changing the way they view their own people, their own brothers and their own sisters. Changing how they view women, how women view men. Now, not only that, I gotta dress a certain way to look, to play the part. Because if I don't dress like this, then I'm not really for the culture. See, that's how they infiltrated communities. That's how they infiltrated our people. When you go back and you look at how our people used to dress in the 50s and the 60s. Class. Modesty at best. Right? The women dressed as women and the men dressed as men. In this day and age, you don't know who's who. And that was all strategically being done through the entertainment. Because why? The entertainment sector of all of these things dictates what's cool, what's in, what's the norm. So we gotta be able to expose that and be like, yo, this is not normal. I'm not dressing like a girl. I'm not doing that. That's not the drug use is not cool. We gotta expose that because the fake is winning. Is that really reality?
The way the woman used to dress, where the men used to be. Hollywood shifts the society to follow these, like, you should be like this. This is the normal. This is the norm.
See?
This is the norm. Don't be strange. Don't be weird. Be like us. Be like us. Have you
like
sat
us.
Down and read the actual lyrics of the music?
Mm-hmm.
It calls to filthy things,
mm-hmm.
dirty name talking. This is the stuff we listen to for enjoyment, unfortunately, today. This is what people listen to. It's a message, essentially. And whether or not music takes that effect to you, where you start acting like that, you behave like that, it's kind of like, in a sense, programming you.
In order to become rich and famous in the eyes of the mainstream media, you must sell your soul to the devil and obey him and his minions. Although these famous people may appear to live extravagant lives and have millions of dollars, they are in reality the most depressed people on this earth. That is because they sold their true eternal life for this temporary worldly life.
So they go to the Hollywood Cemetery and apparently Michael Jackson is buried there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, whether I know if that's true or not, Allahu Alam, God knows best. And the next thing he asks her is like, I would need you to submit and prostrate to this grave. Just put your head down out of respect to Michael Jackson, just prostrate to him. And my wife knows in the religion of Islam, we're not allowed to bow down to anyone except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a human being. What can this human
He's
being
dead alone, and he's dead. Dead in the grave.
Yeah, like just because he was a quote unquote star, it doesn't mean anything.
Mm-hmm.
So my wife was like, no.
Associating partners with Allah is the biggest sin which leads to eternal punishment if a person dies without repenting.
I don't watch TV anymore.
Yeah.
All right, that's something that, because you're talking about some Allah joint, but, you know. But what he was saying was right on point. Right? These people have sold themselves. Matter of fact, I had played this video a while back. I'm going to try to see if I can find it. Right? And this video is very eerie, but very telling. But very telling as well. Let me pull this video up. I know a lot of you guys remember this video too. Is this it? Yeah, hold on. All right. I remember this video right here. Right? Let me pull it up real quick. Just to show you guys that a lot of them know. They know exactly who they serve. Y'all remember this video right here? Y'all remember Bob Dylan? It's a short clip of Bob Dylan admits he sold his soul to the devil for a short life of fame or fortune and fame. Look, let's take a look at this. Just listen to how eerie this sounds.
You're still out here doing these songs, you know, you're still on tour.
I do, but I don't take it for granted.
Why do you still do it? Why are you still out here?
Well, it goes back to the destiny thing. I mean, I made a bargain with it, you know, a long time ago, and I'm holding up my end.
What was your bargain?
To get where I am now.
Should I ask who you made the bargain with?
with the chief commander.
What?
On this earth?
In this earth and then in a world we can't see.
Y'all see his face? It's like he's ashamed to say it, but he gotta say it.
To get where I'm holding up my end.
He said, I'm holding up my end. He made a bargain with it. Let me go back.
The destiny thing. I mean, I made a bargain with it, you know.
I made a bargain with it. Just, my thing is like, don't be ashamed. You know what you did. Just come out and say what you did. You speak it in code. I made a bargain with it. With who? Say it.
Long time ago, and I'm holding up my end.
What was your bargain?
To get where I am now.
Should I ask who you made the bargain with?
with the chief commander.
On this earth?
In this earth and then in a world we can't see.
With the chief commander. And notice how the interviewer strategically ask, on this earth? Y'all caught that?
On this earth, chief commander.
On this earth?
he's laughing.
Chief commander.
On this earth?
On this. Like, why would you ask that question? Why would you say on this earth? Oh, on this earth? He said on this earth and in a world that we can't see. In a world that we can't see. Matrix, anyone?
with the chief commander.
On this earth?
On this earth and then in a world we can't see.
In a world that we can't see. Like, and this just went over everybody's head like, okay, he's just, who? But the thing is, who is he talking about? Who exactly is he talking about? And the devil said unto him, Luke 4:6, all this power will I give thee and the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me, and to whomsoever I will give it. And to whomsoever I will give it.
with the chief chief commander
on this earth,
and this earth, and then in the world we can't see.
So now, for somebody to say that our Bible is man-made, how do you explain that? He's basically telling us he took the offer that was given to Christ, and they want to say that this book was written by a man. I mean, go ahead, y'all could keep thinking that. Go ahead, but there's hundreds of thousands of people who bargain with this thing, the same bargain that Christ was given, and he turned it down. But these people, they couldn't help it, and think about it like this too. Look, let me go back to this. When it says, and the, right in verse 5, it says, and the devil taking him up into a high mountain, showed unto him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. So you don't think that when the devil showed these people all the kingdoms, he was showing them what they would look like in the kingdom, or what they would look like in these selling out arenas? Yeah, I'm going to give you all of this. Yeah, you want your name in lights? No problem. You want your name on a star? Yeah, I got you. You want to be in 10 blockbuster movie videos? I got you. But this is what I require, though. Just do it. And the thing is, a lot of people just think that the worship was just falling down and worshiping him. His worship is tied to other things as well, too. Sacrifices. Being immoral. A lot of things on the left-hand side that these people go into just to have a false reality. Can't make this stuff up. Look at this. Let me read this with y'all, right? Let me go to the book of Psalms. And I'm going to read this, right? Take a look at this. And a lot of us grew up reading this scripture too. Psalm 23. Right, so a lot of you guys probably know that. Notice Psalm by heart, as you should. Right, Psalm 23, a psalm of David. It says, "The Lord is my shepherd; I shall not want." So, right then and there, it tells you already. If the Lord is your shepherd, there is nothing that you will lack. There is nothing that you're going to have to bargain for to receive. I mean, if he's your shepherd, everything that you will ask for will be given to you. I also want to show this as well, too. I got to show this now since I already went to that. So right then and there, it tells us the Lord is our shepherd. We shall not want. Look at this. I'm going to go to Psalm 17 now. And I was reading this earlier. And I was like, yo, wow, this is truly, truly amazing when you actually read this, right? So Psalm 17 and 13, it says, "Arise, O Lord. Disappoint him. Cast him down. Deliver my soul from the wicked, which is in thy sword. From men which are thy hand, O Lord, from men of the world, which have their portion in this life, and whose belly thou fillest with the hid treasure. They are full of children, and leave the rest of their substance to their babes." Now here's the key part right here, verse 15. "As for me, I will behold thy face in righteousness. I shall be satisfied when I awake with thy likeness. And when I went into the Hebrew word there for the word satisfied there, right? I believe the Hebrew word that was there was sabaya, right? Which is to satisfy. But there was one definition in there, in the word satisfied, that pointed out to me. It says, I shall be satisfied. So when he said, I shall be satisfied, one of the definitions says to have enough. To have enough, brothers and sisters. So that being satisfied is to have enough. That means the Most High will make sure or provide everything in your life that you need to sustain. There's no guarantee. There's no guarantee that in this life that you would be rich above measure. There's no guarantee that you would have everything that you ever asked for. But the guarantee, if the Lord is your shepherd, is that you will have enough. Now, the question is, brothers and sisters, how many of you guys in the chat right now lack anything? And when I say lack anything, I'm not talking about some of your vain desires, because we all have vain desires. There's certain things that we want in this life, which is not a crime to want it, but it's vain. You could live without it, and you could live if you have it. So it's not a necessity. But I'm talking about things that are necessities. And now, according to the scriptures, what are things that are necessities? Huh? Look, let me go there. Matthew 6. Like I said, that Hebrew word there, which means to be satisfied, is, and the definition said, to have enough. And sometimes, brothers and sisters, we think that we're not where we're supposed to be because we don't have what we want. But the Most High makes it that way. We have what you need. And that's always how the Most High operated. He's always going to give you what you need to continue. Especially when we look at the ministry. Christ told the disciples, he's like, yo, provide neither scrip, purse nor scrip. Don't bring more than one shoe. Don't bring no food. And whatever house you enter into, salute it. And whatever they provide you to eat, eat. For a workman is worthy of his hire. Showing that the ministry itself will feed you. The ministry itself will sustain you. The Most High will put everything on your path to continue to sustain you. And you shall be satisfied. You will have enough. So that word satisfied there is not just, oh, I'm going to be happy. I got everything that I want. Sometimes your satisfaction may not be happiness, but it may be just be you have enough. And we got to look at it like that, because the Most High is doing good on his part. It's just sometimes in our vain mind, we want more. And that's just human nature. It's human nature to want more. And some people want more to the point where they allow themselves to make deals with the devil. Because they can't have it. They don't have enough. Or they feel that they don't have enough. They feel like they don't have enough. I hope y'all understand that. Y'all getting that, right? So I'm in Matthew 6, right? Let me read this real quick. I'm going to read this Matthew 6. So Matthew 6 and 25, right? Y'all got to hear this out. Sometimes what we want may not be on the agenda. And you know, I battle with that sometimes too. You know, sometimes we want, like, yeah, I want this, I want that. But like, yo, is it necessary? Is that what the Most High want for you? And we get, sometimes we get frustrated when we don't get what we desire, but then we don't look at everything that the Most High is providing at the current time. I can't say I've ever went to bed, all praises be to the Most High, without a meal. Or even if I didn't have a meal, I had something to eat that day. I had something to drink. I have changing clothes to put on. I have a bed that I could sleep in. So these are the key essential things that shows us that we don't really need nothing else. Anything else that we get outside of that is a plus. And if the Lord is your shepherd, he's going to put it in your path so that way it could be used for the ministry. It could be used for the kingdom. So that's why he woke you up for. Because you should know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Matthew 6:25, it says, therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, nor yet for your body, what ye shall put on. Is not the life more than meat, and the body than raiment? He said, isn't this life more than just eating food or the designer clothes you're putting on your back? Life is bigger than that. So this is exactly what he's saying. Behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns. Yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not much better than they? Which of you, by taking thought, can add one cubit unto his stature? And why take ye thought for raiment? Meaning clothes. Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow, they toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you, that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Wherefore, if the Most High so clothe the grass of the field, which is today is, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you? O ye of little faith. Therefore, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or wherewithal shall we be clothed? For all these things do the Gentiles seek. This is why they could easily make deals like this with the devil. They could easily go off on a limb. They could eat those who don't believe. They could easily go off and make deals like that. They feel like they don't have enough. For all these things do the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of all these things. And yes, the Most High knows the things that we have need of. This is the reason why he's provided us with just enough. He's given us enough. Some of us more than others. But he's given us enough that we need to survive, to sustain. And the Most High have always been like that. It's just us. We just want more. We just be wanting more. And now I want to ask, do we think or do we feel like that's an insult to the Most High? That we want more than what he's providing? Do we think it's wrong that we do that? Or should we just, or do we have to put it, or he allows us to think like that, to put it in perspective, like, yo, consider this, consider that. Do we consider at all? We have to start considering. Right? Here's the end all be all. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. All of these things shall be added unto you. So we got to understand our purpose and our duty to our God. The same way how we just seen how he understood his duty to his God. If I can play it one more time. This guy is so eerie.
My hand.
What was your bargain?
To get where I am now.
Should I ask who you made the bargain with?
with the chief commander.
On this earth?
In this earth and then in the world we can't see.
In the world we can't see. So, you see, they clearly understand the choices that they make. And I always say this, if you went into that water and you got baptized, that means you consciously made a choice. And you have to uphold your end of the bargain. That's how it works. You made a deal with the Most High to no longer chase this world. To leave it all behind and to follow Christ. And to put on Christ. So that means when you get out that water, that means you have an obligation to fulfill a duty. To fulfill your end of the bargain. And look how beautiful the Most High is. You fulfilling your part of the bargain and what he does in return. But seek ye first the kingdom of the Most High and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. So if you uphold your part of the bargain, his part of the bargain is right here. That and then some. All these things shall be added unto you, and not withholding everlasting life. Now, which deal you think is better? Now let's put it in perspective. Which deal you think everybody would more so want? The deal that comes with the devil, or the deal that comes with the Most High? And you see, people are not presented with both choices. And this is where I feel like, you know, of course it's not fair. But at the end of the day, the truth is being hid. And if we're the ones who have the truth, we have to be the ones to expose the reality of this thing. Because what we're seeing on the TV and in these sport arenas, in these movie theaters, in these record labels, none of this, that's not real. It's not real. It was never meant to be real. It was given to mankind to give you a false sense of reality so you can fall to the wiles of the devil. So it's very important that we are able to distinguish the real from the fake. Very important. Because if we don't, we gonna fall for anything. I'm telling y'all right now. We're gonna fall for anything, brothers and sisters. And that's not something that I would want for anybody, to fall to the wiles of the devil. Right? And like I said, man, we have a lot of work to do, brothers and sisters. We actually have a lot of work to do. Hold on, give me one second. We actually have a lot of work to do. Right? Oh, y'all already know what time it is, brothers and sisters. This week on Finding the Stupor, will we find it? Is this even real? I mean, at this point, we can't make none of this stuff up anymore, man. I don't even understand how any of this could be made up. But brothers and sisters, we gotta go into this, because as we see the days approaching, or the times is coming to an end, and we're walking into the consummation of times, Christ or the Most High explained to us, what are the signs of his coming? And this, brothers and sisters, if this isn't the days of Noah, somebody explain to me what we got going on here. Somebody explain to me, what is this that we got going on here? Huh? Shout out to Elder Ari. I seen this on his page, and I was like, yeah, I got to play this today, because like, what is going on here? Leave the Christian church immediately. What is this?
Oh, come on. You can get what you need. Fill out the form with your friends. And fill it with a thank you. Fill it with I love you. You can say thank you. If you can breathe, you can say hallelujah.
So no one sees anything wrong with this right now? Like, does anybody in the crowd?
If you can breathe, you got a right. After all the hell you went through, you got a reason. Oh, come on, you can give what you need. Fill out the form with your friends. Fill it with a thank you. Fill it with I love you. You can say thank you. If you can breathe, you can say hallelujah. If you can breathe, you got a right. After all the hell you went through, you got a reason.
Yeah. Yeah. I really don't know what that was. Even if I tried to explain it, I wouldn't be able to. I don't know what he had. I don't know what it was. And the thing is, I don't even understand how can the people in the crowd not even understand what it has to be the stupor. For you to be sitting up in there carrying on like that, like he wasn't. Hold on. What? Look at the what is this? You see his shoulders? Is that a shirt? That's a man blouse? And look how you clapping his hands. That's not how a man clap their hands.
You can get what you need. Fill out the form.
I guess all you gotta do is just play loud music, and I think the loud music blinds people from what they're actually seeing. I think there's something to that. So all we gotta do is play loud music, and it distracts you from what you're actually seeing. It doesn't matter anymore. It's all an illusion. It's the stupor. But yeah, I definitely had to play that. So real quick, what I'm doing is, yo, praise him. Yo, matter of fact, let me clap it up to the Most High, man. Let me clap it up that we all have been delivered, and we don't have to ever go through nothing like that. Praise the Most High that we not under no spell. I praise the Most High that we not under that spell, and we could see the madness for what it is, man. That's St. John chapter 8, verse 32. Y'all don't really understand how far that scripture goes. Y'all don't understand. Y'all do not understand how far that scripture goes. When Christ said, "Ye shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free," brothers and sisters, he was talking about that madness too. Because there's no way you're going to be in your right mind and have somebody like that lead you into worship, lead you into prayer. I can't do it. I couldn't do it. And it looked like there was a strong brother right next to him, a strong man. Oh, let me see that.
With your friend, it's silly with a fashion.
Look at these grown men.
Love you. You can say thank you.
Matter of fact, he's a grown man, but what?
You can breathe. You can.
And he's, look at him, he's trying to fix the shirt. Ain't no fixing it, man.
Hey, hallelujah. If you can breathe, you got a right.
Look at these. Strong grown men. Catching a fit. I don't understand. I don't even know. But praise the Most High that we have eyes to see. We have eyes to see, brothers. We have eyes to see, man. We could see what's fake, and we could separate that from what's actually reality. Right? So I got Brother Eric in. You gotta hook up your mic. You can unmute yourself whenever you're ready. You can unmute yourself whenever you're ready, brother.
Okay, Shalom, Deacon.
Hey, Shalom, what's going on, Ak?
All right, I'm blessed, man. I'm blessed by this lesson. Let me cut the audio off on the YouTube. I just want to start out with this lesson is so powerful, and it kind of ties into a lesson I gave about 2 weeks ago. You know, when you talk about the Matrix, there's so much information in that story, and you just brought out how Satan will only show you one hand.
Mm-hmm.
You know, how it would be so easy if we know that the Most High has an opportunity for us and that Satan has an opportunity.
Yep.
And we have to make a decision. So please go directly, if you haven't gone, go to Deuteronomy chapter 30.
Oh, let's go there.
And let's start at verse 14. Man, I was like, oh my goodness.
You said Deuteronomy what?
Chapter 30, starting with verse 14.
Let me get that real quick.
Okay, Shalom, please.
Here it goes. Deuteronomy 30 and 14.
Yes, sir.
But the word is very nigh unto thee, in thy mouth and in thy heart, that thou mayest do it.
That's right. We have a choice. We have the word right here in front of us.
Mm.
And we must get that understanding because the truth is right here. But what are we doing with it? You know, a lot of people are honoring him with their mouth, but what about their heart? Their heart is far from me, that the word tells us. And we just saw it in the video you showed.
Mm.
They have a love of Christ, but it's not according to the scriptures, not according to the word. This is not about hooping and hollering and dancing and pretending that something got a hold of you. And something does have a hold of those folks, but it's not the God that we serve. So I want to be clear. Let's go to 15.
15. See, I have set before thee. This is a great scripture. See, I have set before thee this day life and good and death and evil.
There you go. He's letting you know both sides, as Deacon brought out earlier. You can choose life and good, or you have the opportunity to choose death and evil. Go ahead, verse 16.
Verse 16, it says, in that I command thee this day to love the Lord thy God, to walk in his ways, and to keep his commandments, and his statutes, and his judgments, that thou mayest live and multiply.
So he's telling you what I am going to give you. I am going to give you life, and you're going to have life more abundantly if you seek the kingdom. As you brought out early, seek ye the kingdom, and everything is going to be added unto you. Read on.
Where are we at? It says, and to keep his commandments and his statutes and his judgment, that thou mayest live and multiply. And the Lord thy God shall bless thee in the land whither thou goest to possess it.
That's right. We'll be blessed wherever we go. We will be in the eye of the storm, whether we in Babylon or anywhere else on the face of the earth. He's going to protect us if we choose life. Verse 17.
Let me get that.
Mm-hmm.
And it says, but if thine heart turn away so that thou will not hear, mm-hmm. but shall be drawn away and worship other gods and to serve them, I denounce unto you this day that ye shall surely perish, and that ye shall not prolong your days upon the land whether thou possesses over the or sorry passes over the Jordan to go to possess it.
So if you make the wrong decision chasing after what the world is doing, mm-hmm. because you have not been transformed by the renewing of your mind, if you want to continue to walk in darkness, you're going to have a rude awakening. You're going to have a short life, because we know it's not about this life. It's about the one that's going to come in the hereafter. Mm-hmm. Go to 19.
Right. Verse 19, it says, I call heaven and earth to record this day against you, that I have set before you life and death, mm-hmm. blessing and cursing.
I put it out there again. Mm-hmm. You have life and death. Your choice. You can choose blessing or cursing. Go ahead.
Therefore, choose life, that both thou and thy seed may live.
There it is.
Powerful.
He's letting you know, I am telling you the right one to choose, and that is me. So I'll leave it there, but praise be to the Most High, brother, for this lesson, man.
All praises. All praises. The water my ox for that scripture.
No problem.
Yes, sir. So as you can, that brother was right on with that scripture. A lot of us, and it goes back to what I was saying, too. You see how our God, what he does, he presented to us. He presents the good, and he also presents the evil. But this world, or how Satan presents it, he's only going to present the evil, but he's going to present it as good. And he doesn't give those who don't have understanding the proper choice. And like I said in the beginning of this video, or the beginning of the broadcast, that nobody in their right mind would actually choose to do evil. That's not something that people say, you know what, I'm going to just be evil rather than be good. So somehow the evil that he presents is presented unto us as good. Right? And therefore... You know, us as mankind, we make these bad choices. So, I think the brother for bringing out that scripture, because that was really, really on point, and really and it really goes and proved the what I was saying from the beginning, how our God is not going to do what the God of this world would do. He's not going to withhold the information. He said, "I'm going to give you the truth." But with that truth, I got to show you what the evil is so you can be able to make a conscious choice. I set before you good and evil, life and death. Praise the Most High for that scripture. So I got Brother Allen in. My big brother. Brother Allen Bonds, what's going on?
Shalom.
Shalom. How's everything?
Très bien. That means very good.
Yes, sir. That's in French. Yes, sir.
Hey, I saw you was doing the thing, and you was talking about the actress and the musicians and the different thing and modeling. Mm. Man, I don't know if you know about it out there in Hollywood, you know, in California, where those women go out there and try to get into modeling and being actresses and musicians.
Oh, yeah.
Some of them drop through the cracks, and they get into this thing called P-O-R-E-N.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, yeah, of course. A lot of them, yeah. Man. You know?
It's sad.
And because they can't act, and they're not actors, mm-hmm. and they get into that. And a lot of, you'd be surprised, there's a couple of them that's pretty famous. They used to be in, and they got real famous, but that's where they got their start.
Yeah, matter of fact, not just them. A lot of people, a lot of A-list celebrities started that route, too. I just found out about Sylvester Stallone, Rocky.
How about Arnold Schwarzenegger?
Yeah, of course.
And there's some women, too, that was in that, too. And they became actors. Some of them was in there, and they came out of that industry. And like Damon Whistling was telling you, because I've been to California, and I stayed on Hollywood Boulevard. And you know what? When you go to Paramount and stuff, and you go and see, it's like a bunch of warehouses where you go on these different studios. The Price is Right is over there. Days of My Life is over here. This is over here. And it man, that's like the ghetto over there on Hollywood, man. If you saw that, it looked like Beetlejuice.
It's crazy.
Beetlejuice up there, man. I stayed in a hotel over there, some Chinese people, and I was like, oh, you know? It's like, it ain't well what it's cracked up to be. And I'm so glad that I didn't go into that too deep in there. You know, I know some people still in the music business, and you know, I have somebody that I do business with them because, you know, for clothes and stuff like that. So I said, hey, you never been to one of them D parties, have you? And he said, no. I said, well, one of your boys, I heard what's called talking about him one time on the TV, and he jumped back like that. I said, don't go there, man. Stay away from them. You can get their money, but stay far away from them, brother. And they be done got you caught up into something.
I know, Brother Allen. I know you for a time. You know, well known musician. What was the name of your group again?
It was Transnational Funk, but it used to be part of that band. Used to be the Dad's Band,
right?
You know, so Whip It Baby.
But let me ask you though. Let me ask you real quick. I know you was a part of the Transnational Funk, right? And you guys used to tour, right?
Yeah.
So have you witnessed or seen anything crazy coming up doing the music thing?
Yeah. They got certain parties that they, you know, it's like one time there was an America Bandstand or something like that, and there's out there Gerald LaVert and R. Kelly and them. They used to laugh at R. Kelly, you know, Gerald LaVert and them. That group there, Sean and Gordon, they come from Cleveland. So
yeah,
you go over there and they got this food, man. It look, you know, you ever seen that program, The Addams Family?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, yeah.
That's the kind of food they was having over there.
Oh, yeah?
You want the eye of moat? You want the eye of, eat the eye of octopus? Or do you want to eat octopus? Do you eat, you know, what do you call them? Ostrich eggs? Or you eat the eyeball of an ostrich or something like that, and all the crazy stuff, man.
They call it exotics. You know? Exotic food.
Exotic. You talking about Adam's Family food, man.
Yeah.
Crazy stuff. I never wanted to go. Oh, no. I don't want to go. I'm going home. I'm going to read my Bible. Man, you should have. I said, no, I shouldn't have went to that party.
You didn't have a tentacle? Not a tentacle?
I didn't have none of that garbage, man. You crazy? I looked at Adam's Family. Will you please pass the family sauce? The monsters. I said, no, that's all right, man.
Oh,
you
man.
Know, it's crazy, man, out there, man. The things I've seen and the people, and so many of them died, man. You know, it's too much, man. I'm glad the Most High God, he protected me, because I've seen a lot, man. A lot of them. They ain't here no more, because you can't serve two masters, man.
No, you can't, right.
You can't.
Yeah.
It's impossible.
Definitely impossible.
And they're not going to let you go to that door unless you compromise. It's like they get that blackmail tape on you. You know what I mean? And all
That's
of
them, thing,
you know,
yeah.
anybody, he told it. Damon Wilson told the truth, and I know it. Everybody, they compromise. All of them. You name them. Anybody you see out there, they compromise in some kind of way, man. They got a tape on them. You do this? Okay. Oh, what happened to your cousin? Oh, what happened to your mother? Oh, they had an accident. Oh, car accident. Oh, the brakes went out and stuff, man. Oh, the airplane went down. Oh, okay. You know? I remember the guy that, and I was in Colorado, I was with this Christian church, and I went there in Colorado. You know, it's called Young Light. Some people might know. And it was a Christian thing for high school kids and stuff. So we went out there, and I met John Denver. And I went up to him and talked to him. And I told him, I said, I play instrument too. That was when I was high school. And he said, well, you keep on doing it. The next week, he died in some kind of helicopter accident, man. You know? You know, I was telling the elder, Otis Redney, we used to play with his band, the Barcades.
Right.
They're from Memphis. We recorded with them. We opened up for them for a month. No, a year. And at some place down there in Atlanta, so I forget what it is, some club there. And it's like, we used to do this thing called the Chitlin Circuit. You understand? That's when I used to eat chitlins, but not no more.
That's good. That's good.
You know, it's a way that we go, you know, come from, you know, New York, Memphis, Chicago, going down south and everything. And you do all of Newport New and all that stuff. And it's like, man, it's crazy, man. Them groups, some of them groups are still out there, like Cameo and, you know, Morris Day. I almost beat him up one time.
That was the past life. That was the past life.
Yeah, it's a past life. Yeah, but, yeah. You know, them guys, man, they something else, man. But they still doing it, you know. And I see them. You know, sometimes I know somebody at work with them. I say, oh, they still going. I said, well, I said, you know, you can get this truth, bro. You want this truth, you know. But you see these people out there just like Demond was talking about. They're out singing. Like Frankie Beverly, I think he was trying to talk about, and Freddie Jackson. I'm like, this dude, what, your voice is gone, man. What are you doing up there? But see, they can't get out of it. They got to stay in it, like Bob Dylan said.
Yeah, they got to bargain.
Yeah,
they
got to keep going. I know some people 82 years old still singing out there, man. I'm like, man. What, you got enough money? Oh, I got to do this. Because if I don't do it, you know what's going to happen to me. You know, they sign it's sold over to the devil, man. And it's crazy. You know, I see these people, man. And people say, oh, he died like that. He died that Elder Carr, he hit a home run, a doggone, what you call a grand slam. Don't believe that stuff you see on that doggone TV, man. You talking about television.
Right.
They tell it, man, just like Marvin Gaye said, I heard it through the great grind. When he heard it through the grapevine, he heard it from the musicians.
Right.
Like me. We know what really go down. They give you a half story. You get going on YouTube and they'll tell you stuff. But you sat down with them by yourself with no microphone, they'll tell you what happened.
Right.
You know, it's a whole bunch of stuff, man, that's going on. We at the end here. We're really at the end here, man. I'm glad I praise the Most High God and keep playing. I'll be in that show over there in Atlanta, you know.
All praises.
And Augusta, I'm going to be there. I hope you see you there too, bro.
Oh, you know. I won't be there this time around.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, there's other stuff going on. Of course. You know about Stevie's thing, right?
Yeah. I gotta connect with him about that. I'm
gonna be there too.
Yeah, I gotta connect with him.
We gotta keep it in the family.
Of course, you already know.
Not keep it in the closet. Keep it in the family.
In the family.
You know? Yeah, keep it in the family with the Israelite music and stuff. And by the way, I got two black cats, you know? And, you know, they Israelite cats. They don't eat no shrimp, crab, and lobster.
Oh, praise the Most High. Listen, you keep them cats eating kosher, all right?
Yeah, they kosher, man. You better watch out. They'll fight you. They Israelites.
Oh, praise. All right, my brother, I'm going to put you back in the queue. I got to play this video. Well, it's always a pleasure.
Shalom.
All right, shalom, my brother.
All praises.
All praises. My brother, Allen, saxophone. Right, that's crazy. I had two saxophone players call just now. I guess the music part of the of the music industry part of the broadcast really touched them. Two of my saxophone player brothers. All praises. Right, but I'm gonna play this video real quick. Right, because he was mentioning Brother Allen. He was mentioning Hollywood, and I had seen this video and I was thinking about playing it. I was like, I ain't got no need to play it. But now, you know, since he brought that out, let me transition real quick and play this video. It says, Hollywood Boulevard is a disaster. Can it be fixed? And I'm telling y'all, Hollywood Boulevard,
Y'all, they make it seem like it's like everything, but that joint look crazy. But let's take a look at this.
Fantasize about this place called Hollywood. Celebrities, entertainment, opportunity, stars. The allure of Hollywood in Los Angeles drives 10 million tourists each year to take a stroll on the Walk of Fame. The allure makes it the number one tourist destination in the entire city. And while Hollywood as a neighborhood actually makes up less than 1% of LA City in square miles, it really always has been a place, at least for locals, to avoid. But can that change? And what's going on in Hollywood lately? Okay, we can do this. Welcome to Hollywood.
I want to get to the meat of it.
Okay, you kind of have to laugh. I just parked next to Hollywood High School, and as I'm getting out of my car, a tour bus passes me by, and I hear the driver say, "This is where they filmed the movie Grease." Thinking that was actually really cool, I looked it up and fact-checked it, and it's not true, okay? Grease was not filmed at Hollywood.
So the guy actually lied, all right?
Hold on real quick.
Testing. Yeah. So the guy actually lied.
High school, it was filmed at three other high schools, primarily Venice High School. And it just goes to...
I want to see... Hold on. There's something else that I wanted to see part of this documentary, because I don't know if he's going to really touch on it. The level of homelessness that's going on in Hollywood. I don't think he touched on none of this. Yeah, this is... I should have looked at it first, but I thought he was going to show the homelessness, like how crazy it is in Hollywood, what they call it, Boulevard. But yeah, brothers and sisters, everything that glitters is not gold. All right, we clearly could see through tonight's discussion that, where am I? One second. Yeah, we clearly could see that the deception is really out there, and it's really upon us, right? It's really upon us to be able to decipher the deception. And I'm a keep keying in on what Christ said. Christ said it clearly, man. He said, "Yo, ye shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free." So once again, I want to give all praise to the Most High that we actually know the truth. He has presented us the truth along with the lies. So now as believers, we can make a conscious effort to make a better choice for ourselves, our families, and the people that we run into. Let me go into the comment section. Maybe if there's any questions in the comment section, I'll read those off real quick. Still early. I got some time. Right. But once again, peace and blessings, shalom to everybody who is in the room. Right. Thank you guys for coming in. Thank you guys for being a part of the broadcast. Let me see. Let me go to the chat real quick. Right. We can go to the chat real quick. If not, then, you know, like I said, I'm not going to hold y'all long, because this is a straightforward show. And we were able to, but it's just funny how the Bible just clears up everything. Like some people search a lifetime to try to figure out what's what. And we just crack open the Bible and was able to get some resolve. So praise the Most High for that. Right. And I'm happy that you guys are here. You guys are enjoying the broadcast. I see you in the chat. But like, if you don't want to, like I said, I got the Zoom link out. If you guys just want to ask a question in the chat, I'll take some questions right now, because I want to sign off and get some other things done out here, you know? And she was like, always okay. We're going through the chat, seeing if there's any questions or comments. And I really hope that
you guys were edified through this broadcast, especially if you're brand new and you have no clue of what this is. Hopefully you was able to receive some resolve, right? And able to make a conscious choice moving forward. Understanding reality from fiction, right? I guess everything, let me see. I don't see anything here. All right. Let me see here. All right, yeah. Holly Weird, yes, of course. All right, brothers and sisters. So, yeah, that's the show in a nutshell. That's the show in a nutshell. Right? So, I'm happy that we was able to get all of that out. And please don't forget to enroll in the Hebrew and Bible Academy. Right? We're still taking enrollments. HistoryTimes.org, brothers and sisters. For more in-depth studies, more in-depth information, because there's only so much you could get from these broadcasts, from, you know, Elder REI, Elder Ricard, myself, Elder Ramah, forgetting his name, who streams on Fridays. There's only so much you could get, but in the Hebrew and Bible Academy, that's where you get the foundation. That's where you get your study on, brothers and sisters. So if you really want to become scholars for the Most High, you really want to be in the know, you want to know, brothers and sisters, Hebrew and Bible Academy, historytimes.org. Akyatazayab says, Deacon, did you see my post about Genesis 2 and 16 and 17? No, I didn't see your post about Genesis 2, 16 and 17. Would you like me to read it if that's the case? I would read it real quick because I didn't see your post. And while you think, let me go there. You said Genesis 2, 16 and 17. Let's read it. Let's read it real quick. Why not? Genesis 2, 16 and 17. So it says, of course, and the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof thou shalt surely die. Right, we understand that tree was there, and the Most High did not want them to eat from that particular tree. But I need to see the post or your question concerning that. Okay, he commented and says, we're told about the good and not the bad. And not, I guess you're trying to say, and not the bad. In the beginning, there was no reason for them to be presented with evil. There was no reason for them to be presented with evil because everything that the Most High created was good. So now the fact that they've sinned and went against the Most High and evil was presented, now for the future generations, you would have to be presented with the choice now. There was no choice. There was no choice in the beginning because everything was created good. There was no reason for them to show them evil because evil was not present on earth or within man, I should say. Evil was there, but it was not within man. But because it was sown into man, now, to be fair, he have to present to you good and evil. I'm hopefully that makes sense, or if that's probably something that you were struggling with, you didn't understand why the Most High didn't present to them evil. There was no need to, because everything that was created from the beginning, he looked at it and he said it was good. So if everything is good, why do I need to give you a difference between evil and good? Everything I made was good. It's because the enemy came and sown evil. Now I gotta be a just God and be like, you know what, since evil is here, I got to show you this is what's evil,
and this is what's good. Now you choose what you want to follow, because I'm telling you to do good. Now it's your choice. So hopefully that makes more sense. Hopefully if that was you, if that's something you were struggling with, hopefully it makes sense. Yatazabia. Or Yatazayab. Marlon says, great lesson as usual. All praises be to the Most High for the insight. Khan Frida says, Satan planted that. Of course, yes, we know that. And you would know that if you joined the Hebrew and Bible Academy. You would get a full in-depth breakdown of the beginning, right? And what was happening. Caleb, that tree was planted by Azazel. Yes, it was planted by the wicked ones, by the deceivers. See, they're not going to give you the full truth. They're going to give you their truth, but it's evil. Oh, okay. He says, I agree. He said, agreed. The Most High told them not to, but they chose the evil. Khan, yes, they did choose the evil, right? But guess what, though? They chose the evil, but how was it presented to them? Goes back to what I was saying from the beginning. How was it presented? He did say you'll eat it, but you're not gonna die. You'll be like gods. So they gotta. That's how the devil works. We know his scheme. He didn't change up his game since the beginning of time. So we already know how he gonna move. He don't do nothing new. He always gonna present to you. He always gonna present to you. What glitters, the glittering part of it. But yeah, praise the Most High. Here we go. We got all right, so yes. All right, brothers and sisters, so I really appreciate you guys coming in. I thank you guys for making the stream what it is. The interactions, the calls, and the comments, and for the ones that I could have read. But I appreciate you guys for coming in. But like all good things, this good thing must also come to an end. So all praises be to the Most High for another Shabbat. But yeah, what still praise the Most High for another Shabbat that's coming, right? I know this weekend is coming up. Tomorrow is the prep Friday, right? Is the Sabbath prep. So if you're going to be working, if you're going to be home prepping, make sure you guys do everything accordingly. Try to make sure you guys do things timely so you guys can enjoy the Sabbath with your family, the rest. Be able to bring in the Sabbath the right way with your children, reading scriptures, playing music to the Most High, and truly focusing on the Most High and keeping him the center of the Sabbath as it was intended. So I thank you guys for coming in.
You could be anywhere in the world, but you're now tuned into the Born of Levi Experience.
Yes, yes. So I'll, Most High willing, I'll see you all next week for another broadcast, something that, the Most High would put in my spirit, and I already know it would be for the saints, right? So I praise the Most High that you guys was edified through this broadcast, and and faithful soldier, yes, we did the stupor already. I think you probably just came in, so you might have to catch the repeat or the rerun to catch the stupor. So we did that. We went into that, and boy, was it a stupor. I don't even understand what I was watching, but maybe you might be able to make some sense of it, which I doubt either, because it's crazy. But praise the Most High, brothers and sisters. I love you all. Continue to stay prayed up and sin not, right? Because we all on the same goal, same mission. We're trying to get to Zion. We can't let none of this false reality deter us from the mission, right? So praise the Most High. All praises be to the Most High. Shalom. Good night. Have a blessed night. Have a blessed day tomorrow. Have a blessed Shabbat. Until I see you next week. All praises be to the Most High. Shalom.